three guests, Sunil Alagh, Nayan Parikh, and Sunil Alagh. Sunil Alagh, he is an IIM Calcutta alumnus, former MD and CEO of Britannia Industries. Later, he founded a consulting firm, SKA Advisors, which advises clients on marketing strategies. In 2004, he was appointed as the president of All India Management Association. He has also been the host of the job show on CNBC India, that is India's first televised job hunt on TV. We welcome you, sir. Our next guest, Nayan Parikh. He is an IIM Ahmedabad alumnus. Nayan Parikh is the brain and heart behind the establishment and growth of Nayan Parikh and Consultants as an apex management consulting firm in India. Having earned the status of a management ninja, he has held important positions in several governmental, private and industrial bodies and spearheaded various infrastructural projects all over the country.
Lalit Bhai.
Apart from enviable professional credentials, he is a highly followed orator, motivational speaker, life coach, and a published author of 3 books. He is also a renowned TEDx speaker who is known for his talk on rich and spiritual. We welcome you, sir. Our third guest, Sunil Alagh. Sunil Alagh is the producer of this beautiful festival, Gujarat Literature Fest. He is a serial entrepreneur and he has been a part of 4 enterprises since last 18 years. Why GLF? Why? Why he is a part of GLF? Why he is the producer of GLF? Because of his interest in literature, travel, culture, business, and most importantly, our basic need, food. We welcome you, sir. And I would like to request all the guests to please come on stage. First, I would like to call upon Sunil Alagh to inaugurate the event.
Thank you, Aditya. I would like to welcome all of you to the Gujarat Literature Festival and especially BizLit Fest. So, why a BizLit Fest? Because we are in the land of entrepreneurship, here in Gujarat, business precedes everything else. It's in our blood, it's in our ethos, our identity. So talking about business and its literature and various aspects of it is a natural progression. It's a natural extension to the festival. But as you will see from the sessions which have been planned over the next 3 days, it's not just academic. And it's not just about books. There's a lot of take home. There's this literature and various aspects of it. There's, today evening there's an interesting session on the future of jobs. We have, speakers coming in who are working with Google in the US, talking about the scenario there. And tomorrow we have something on green mobility. And then on Sunday there's an interesting quiz. Okay, so that is testing our knowledge of business and its literature. So combining all of this, and then a very interesting session on Sunday, which is called Ink Tank, which was started in GLF last year, which is going to be its second season. It's about the business of literature. It's about how we can take our literature to the next step, make it a commercially viable pursuit for us. So in that sense, all of this combines together to make it a BizLit Fest, and we hope to take this to the next level in the years going forward.
Check. Hall. 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 Hall.
So I would hall. Like to now invite Check. Our esteemed guests to just have a small inauguration with lamp lighting.
Hall. Hall.
Nayan bhai, aap baju aajao.
Guru me deva sarva kareshu sarvada vakra tunda mahakaya surya koti sama prabha nirvignam
guru me deva
sarva kareshu sarvada.
So we open the Bizlet Fest stage. So I'd like to call upon, first of all, so now the stage is to the masters. Thank you.
Chitu bhai, Nayan bhai.
Must compliment.
Hello.
So compliments to the organizers of GLF who have done this in spite of the difficult situation in the city and all
Into
across.
Why?
Also, on behalf of GLF and on my personal behalf, I am extremely happy to welcome Mr. Sunil Alagh from an Alagh. IIM. This is Ahmedabad, Kolkata. So, instead of a keynote address, we thought that we are a small group and let's take full advantage of it and talk informally to each other on what we think would be kind of, you know, important points that we could talk about. Sunil sahab, Gujarat ke baare mein bataiye, Gujarat ki branding ke baare mein bataiye, ab tak jo branding hui hai wo aap kaise evaluate karte hain, because Gujarat ne ek apni pehchan banayi hai, apne tarike se pehchan banayi hai, entrepreneurship ki pehchan banayi hai, Gujarati paise samajhte hain wo pehchan banayi hai, aur aage ek branding ke liye kya kare, Gujarat ki ek saath aur bhi branding hui hai ki Gujarat mein GDP growth hai par employment growth nahi hai, GDP growth hai par kuch ek jo basic human index hai usme kahin na kahin hum log कुछ एक चैलेंजेस महसूस कर रहे हैं. आपका अब तक का जो गुजरात का ब्रांडिंग है उसके बारे में क्या कहना है और आगे क्या बात हो सकता है आपके हिसाब से गुजरात का, तो प्लीज शेयर योर व्यूज ऑन दैट.
क्या नीचे मुख्य आवाज आ गई.
नहीं, व्हाट यू आस्किंग इज अ गुड क्वेश्चन और मैं हिंदी और अंग्रेजी में दोनों मिक्स करके बोलूंगा. देखिए, आप सोचिए कि गुजरात जो बाहर है उनका इम्प्रेशन है, जो आप टूरिज्म के लिए जो कर रहे हैं, अमिताभ बच्चन का एड्स कर रहे हैं, गुजरात की मिट्टी आके देखिए, ये वो वेरी इफेक्टिव. पर प्रॉब्लम बहुत इंडिया और गुजरात का यही है कि कंपेयर जो हम कंपेरिजन लेते हैं दूसरे कंट्रीज के साथ, वो हम भूल जाते हैं कि वी कैन नॉट बी एवरी थिंग फॉर एवरीबॉडी. तो गुजरात को एक अपना पॉइंट लेना चाहिए या दो मैक्सिमम पॉइंट लेना चाहिए जो गुजरात ओन करती है, जो इंडिया को भी एक और दो पॉइंट लेना चाहिए और वो ही प्रमोट करना चाहिए. फॉर इंस्टेंस मैं देता हूँ, देखिए आप थाईलैंड चले जाइए, थाईलैंड हैज एन इमेज ऑफ बीइंग अ फन प्लेस एंड दे डोंट वेवर फ्रॉम दैट. डजंट मीन यू कांट गो देयर फॉर, आप इकोनॉमिक्स के लिए जाइए, अपने बिजनेस के लिए जाइए, टूरिज्म के लिए जाइए, लेकिन दुनिया भर में उनका है कि अगर आपको आराम करना है, थोड़ा मजा करना है, तो आप थाईलैंड आ जाइए. और उनका जो टूरिज्म, जो नंबर ऑफ पीपल हु विजिट थाईलैंड इज इक्वल वन स्मॉल कंट्री इज मच मोर देन व्हाट ऑल इंडिया गेट्स. बिकॉज जब भी आप इंडिया के बारे में सोचते हैं बाहर जाके, कि भाई साहब हम जाएंगे तो आप कहते रहते हो कि हम तो इतने साल पुराने हैं, हर स्टेट में आप आइए, बट बहुत कंफ्यूजिंग मैसेज हो जाता है। जैसे हमने सीखा है अपने मार्केटिंग में, आप आए हैं अहमदाबाद में, आए हैं कलकत्ता में, कि आप जरा फोकस करिए कि आप क्या कहना चाहते हैं। गुजरात का जो मैं देखता हूँ हमारे तरफ से जो है कि आपका जो स्किल है, वेरी फ्यू गुजरातीज वॉन्ट टू वर्क फॉर समवन एल्स, आई एम नॉट सेइंग ऑल ऑफ इट, बट आपका जो एंटरप्रेन्योर स्किल जो अपने देश अपने धरती में है, वो अपने चाहे छोटा बिजनेस करिए, चाहे आप चाय का दुकान खोलिए जैसे पीएम ने खोला था, या किसी भी, बट आपका है कि एंटरप्रेन्योरशिप स्पिरिट, तो वही ब्रांडिंग आपको लेके चलना है आगे। कि देखिए, सम पीपल कहते हैं कि आप चाहे ऑस्ट्रेलिया चले जाइए, चाहे आप अमेरिका चले जाइए, यू विल फाइंड अ पटेल मोटेल। व्हाई? बिकॉज देव जहां भी जाते हैं वो अपना ही बिजनेस खोलते हैं। एक बड़ा सा जोक है कि कोई गुजराती फुटबॉल प्लेयर कभी नहीं बन सकता है इंग्लैंड और अब्रॉड में, क्यों? बिकॉज यू गिव देम अ कॉर्नर, दे विल ओपन अ शॉप। तो वही उनका हिसाब किताब चलता है। तो इफ आई वॉज टू ब्रांड, चाइना इज नोन कि भैया लार्जनेस इंडस्ट्रियल, कि अगर आपको कोई लो कॉस्ट प्रोडक्शन करनी है तो चाइना जाइए, सिंपल। जापान का एक ही है कि अगर आपको डिसिप्लिन चाहिए और क्वालिटी चाहिए, हम देश हैं। तो एक एक पॉइंट हर देश, थाईलैंड कह रहा है फन, अब हम तो नहीं, नहीं भाई साहब हम योगा भी करते हैं, ये भी करते हैं, हम टॉकिंग अबाउट इंडिया के लेवल पे बहुत कंफ्यूज कर रहे हैं। आप इंडियन को कंफ्यूज कर देंगे कि हम यहाँ क्यों हैं। अगर आप बाहर जाएं तो गुजरात को कहना चाहिए कि भाई साहब फॉर एंटरप्रेन्योरशिप फॉर सक्सेस, लुक एट ऑल द गुजरातीज हु गॉन आउट, ऑल द गुजरातीज हु आर हियर, एवरी वन इज सक्सेसफुल। तो इफ आई वॉज टू ब्रांड फॉर गुजरात, मैं कहूंगा कि सिर्फ आप अपना एंटरप्रेन्योरियल स्पिरिट को लीजिए और वही एक ही पॉइंट दौड़ाते रहिए, देन यू विल सक्सीड। अदरवाइज इफ यू से गुजरात की मिट्टी में, गुजरात की मिट्टी तो सब आएंगे ही आएंगे, टूरिज्म, बट दैट शुड बी अ सब पॉइंट, नेवर द मेन पॉइंट। सो दैट्स द वे आई वुड ब्रांड गुजरात, दैट्स द वे आई वुड ब्रांड इंडिया, दैट्स द, बिकॉज लुक अराउंड यू एंड सिंगापुर ऑल्सो, वॉट इज इट नोन फॉर? वन थिंग। सारे कंट्रीज जो है, ऑस्ट्रेलिया भी देख लीजिए, वो कह रहे हैं हमारे पास बहुत रिसोर्सेज हैं, हमारे पास आइए, हमारे पास लोग नहीं है, कम एंड टेक द फुल पोटेंशियल ऑफ आर रिसोर्सेज। बट एक ही पॉइंट सब कंट्री के पास है, तो हम क्यों इतना ज्यादा बोलते हैं पता नहीं हमें, हम भी ज्यादा ही बोल रहे हैं खुद, बट क्यों बोलते रहते हैं पता नहीं, बस बोलना ही है हमको। एक पॉइंट हमारा कोई सुने या ना सुने, हमको कुछ ना कुछ करना है यहाँ पे। मलेशिया का जो है प्राइम मिनिस्टर महातिर, बहुत सालों पहले आया था और उन्होंने एक चीज बताई थी कि देखिए, यू हैव टू मच डेमोक्रेसी, इंडिया हैज टू मच डेमोक्रेसी। टू मच डेमोक्रेसी मींस एवरीबॉडी हैज अ व्यू ऑन एवरीथिंग, एंड दैट वे नो कंट्री कैन फंक्शन एवर। आई मीन इफ यू हैव एवरीवन, इट्स लाइक गोइंग टू सी अ मूवी, एवरीबॉडी बिकम्स अ फिल्म क्रिटिक, ये एक्टिंग ठीक नहीं थी, वो नहीं, अरे भाई साहब जिसने बनाया है दिल द फिल्म क्रिटिक्स। इट्स लाइक क्रिकेट, एवरीबॉडी बिकम्स एन एक्सपर्ट ऑन क्रिकेट, everybody becomes an expert on movies. We are not experts and we have to realize that. You can have a view but don't try and force your view on others. Aap bolte rahiye, aage badhiye na usse. That's the point that I'll make on branding.
Zarur. And very well made, I think. He says focus on what Gujarat has, where you are strongest. And वो टाटा स्टील वाले बोल रहे थे, हम स्टील भी बनाते हैं, उसकी तरह मत करिए, आप जो बनते हैं, जो है वही बोलिए, एंड have a focus one on that. Sure, I think that makes a lot of sense, and Gujaratis I think have that. So so focusing Gujarat branding on its skill to do business, ye game te logo dhando kari lese, ema to corner aap te dhando kari lese, biju kari lese, abhi kari lese. So Gujarat's way of handling money, doing business is the most important one, and that is one branding of Gujarat that I think we could talk about. Let's talk about entrepreneurship. I mean, he studied at IIM Kolkata, I studied at IIM Ahmedabad, and that makes us who we are. But so far as entrepreneurship is concerned, what are the important features that you think an entrepreneur must have? Because you're dealing with entrepreneur, I think though you were not entrepreneur, you were managing director of a large company. And when you have that, whether or not you own it, you are entrepreneur in your own way. So how would you distinguish between an executive who is an entrepreneur, a real entrepreneur, a chai wala who takes his own risks and rises wherever? How would you look at entrepreneurship?
See, entrepreneurship classic sense is that you should do your own thing. You don't work for anybody. You're creating your own business. and you're moving forward. I could never be an entrepreneur. You have to understand first for yourself, are you built? Because agar everybody becomes an entrepreneur, then it becomes impossible to run anything. If everybody wants to be a general in the army, then again, you need infantry, you need middle, you need everyone. So each person has a role to play. And I was a Punjabi born and brought up in Calcutta. So most Punjabis know how to work. Most Punjabis don't have too much brain. Most Punjabis, I'm just saying, including myself. My mother was a Sardarni, so I always tell everybody that, look, I'm half a Sardar, so I can crack Sardar jokes and nobody can take offense because I'm cracking a joke on myself. See, if you leave a Sardarji or a Punjabi or anybody with a thought-provoking piece of information, he won't know what to do with it. He'll keep it. When you come to see him, he'll give it back to you. Aapko chhod ke gaye the, le jaiye. Because we know how to work. We know how to be told what to do. We know how to then execute better than most places. So I would never have made an entrepreneurship. So first, as an individual, you must ask yourself, are you cut out for being an entrepreneur or not? If not, then you can become an entrepreneur type of person in an organization. And there also, you must always remember that there is a famous saying in all organizations, please, when you're working in an organization like Levers, treat it as your own and work as if it belongs to you and then you'll do better. But the day you start doing it, somebody on top will come and whack you. Ye aapka paisa hai kya? Who the hell are you? Why are you treating it as your own? So you have to learn where to draw the line if you want to have an entrepreneurial spirit in an organization. So once you've decided as an individual what to do, then you can become an entrepreneur. And for me, you know, I've worked out a few things and I speak to a number of young entrepreneurs everywhere. And I say, look, do you have a clear business plan for yourself? Are you just an entrepreneur because you want to open a shop and you don't want to work for anyone? Or have you come up with an idea which you think you need to own and move forward? Have a business plan. And always never be an Abhimanyu in any organization. Because if your business plan fails, you must have a plan B. How are you going to get out? Abhimanyu became a big hero. Huh? Let me tell you, in all of Mahabharata, you will find Abhimanyu went in and killed many fellows. But in the Chakravyuh, he didn't know how to get out. He died. So do you want to be a young guy who will be remembered for you killed a lot of people? Or do you want to come away and say, I also have a plan B? So if you are not succeeding, have a plan B and go ahead and keep on changing your plan. Always. Don't think that one plan works if you're an entrepreneur. And that's very important for me as far as I'm concerned. Then work with passion. And people always talk about, as far as I'm concerned, they have a dream, have a big dream and everything will happen. A lot of people who have become entrepreneurs, they say, okay, to dream. But when things are going wrong and you don't have money and you don't know what's happening and at night you're breaking up in a cold sweat, okay, tomorrow what are you going to do with your business? You don't have enough money to run your business. You don't have any money to pay your rent. That is the real essence of being an entrepreneur. How do you cope with that difficulty? Because for every success, there are 100 failures in plan A. Therefore, always be ready that you are going to persevere, you have a clear vision, and you're going to achieve what you're wanting to achieve. Otherwise, being an entrepreneur and saying, I'm working for someone, I've got entrepreneurial spirit, is something which is, you know, it's always there. See, you must also organize money right from the beginning. You must put down for an entrepreneur that this is the first milestone that I have, which is on my own, I can do so much. And then the second milestone, I will need X amount of money. Who will give it? Because everybody runs around at that time saying, now what? Plan in advance. You go and talk to people and tell them that I'm starting this, I'm not wanting any money from you, but if I achieve this milestone, can I come back? Don't start thinking when you achieve the milestone, because then in a year or two, you will be so frustrated in life that you will turn around and say, what the hell am I up to? You know, where am I going with this? So entrepreneurship is a different ballgame altogether. And I don't think I was cut out for it. I was cut out to work for someone. And yet, you wanted a reasonable amount of independence for yourself. And therefore, you had some spirit of what an entrepreneur has. Otherwise, some part of it is very important. Otherwise, you'll be in the infantry all your life. And that's okay. Where's the skill? If everybody wants to sit behind a desk and work, everybody wants to be a manager, then how do you run any organization, any country? So tomorrow when you go abroad, carpenter or an electrician is valued as much. But in India, अरे आप क्या कर रहे हो? अरे वो तो carpenter है, वो तो हजाम है, he's a barber. He says everyone has a skill today. You know, the demand for electricians and plumbers and everybody else is going up. They earn a hell of a lot of money. All that we need to is to respect that job, respect the skill that that person has, which you don't have. So learn to respect that. That's what's very important.
America mein ek doctor the. Ghar mein unke leak ho gaya bathroom mein. So he called a plumber. Aapne plumber ki baat ki to usse yaad aaya. Plumber ko bulaya ye leak ho raha hai bathroom. So plumber came in a good car, of course, a red car. And then phir wo usne dekha. He just tapped one part, thak, aur band ho gaya. And he says, तो डॉक्टर ने पूछा हो गया मेरा? हाँ बोले हो गया. बोले कितना रुपया? कितना डॉलर वहाँ? तो he says $1,000. मैं डॉक्टर हूँ, इतना काम करता हूँ, कभी $1,000 मिला नहीं है मुझे एक सेकंड के लिए. He says मैं भी पहले डॉक्टर ही था, पर ये धंधे में ज़्यादा कमाई है. तो स्किल्स की बात यह है कि आप डॉक्टर हो, जो भी हो, वॉट आर योर स्किल्स विच आर रिक्वायर्ड इन द सोसाइटी नाउ, एंड यू हैव दोज स्किल्स और नॉट. But I think when we are on skills, other than entrepreneurship, we want to cover the topic of skills which would be required for future of jobs. What would be the future of work? Artificial intelligence, robotics, the landscape is changing. The world is changing around us. What was true when I think Sunil Bhai and I started working from IIM Ahmedabad, I remember that typewriters were used, and then came electronic typewriter. And then the computer. So at that time, whoever came to me asked me only one thing, ki bhai, mujhe computer chalana aata hai. So that was a big qualification. That was the skill which they thought would get them jobs. And then came the, say about 10 years before, when I started hiring driver, a driver would tell me that main automatic gaadi chala sakta hu. Which means that was a skill which was important. In times to come, what would be the skills which would be required? If artificial intelligence and robotics are going to change the landscape, what are the jobs which would be there? What are the jobs which would be taken over by the machines? People think that the lower category jobs, which are blue collar jobs, would be taken over. But even white collar jobs are at risk. Two D's are, I think, the most vulnerable. Driver, because there are now cars which would not need any driver to go around. And doctors. Because they say diagnostic skill. So from blue collar to white collar, from a low skill driver's job to a high skill medical doctor's jobs are now challenged by artificial intelligence, because artificial intelligence can do better diagnosis. Because they would study so many past cases and symptoms and the diseases that they would come up with that very, very fast. And also about skills, there is a game called Go. In Korea. Now that game is about 1,000 times more complex than chess. And so Google had developed a program called AlphaGo. And AlphaGo, about 3 years before, defeated the world champion of that Go game 5 times. So now the artificial intelligence and computers are the ones which could challenge even the most intelligent of the tasks. And therefore, most of the jobs are likely to be taken over by computers, by robotics. The doctors' complex surgeries can be taken over by that. So in that kind of a scenario, where most of our drudgery jobs would be done by computer up till now, that whatever you don't want, you have a cleaning machine, you have a vacuum, you have all the machines that you need, robot to handle your cleaning requirements. So in that situation, if your all jobs are gone, how other jobs would be affected? So usme Sunil bhai, aapka kya manna hai, kya situation rahegi agle 30-40 saal mein ye sab jobs chale jayenge, to what are the skills that they would need actually to be relevant at that time and to hold their jobs?
I'll just give you a cartoon which arrived at after this Go guy beats this individual. So there were two robots now fighting each other. So there's a limit. Men can move out and let the robots fight. Then again you are getting, now which robot is better? So ultimately, at the end of the day, what I feel is, if you talk about doctors not required, ab dekhiye ye, who was that? Bhuvaneshwar. He was detected 3 times. He went in Bangalore to all the docs. Diagnosis was wrong. Till finally, one of the guys has diagnosed him correctly for hernia, and he's now gone into that operation. So there's a limit to what anybody can do with your artificial intelligence and robotic. The danger is, I went to one convention recently, and there's an Israeli, I forget his name, but he's world famous psychologist. He's saying, look, if you allow all this to progress so fast, then you are going to create a class of people who are unemployable. Is the world ready for that? So sometimes a few people are creating artificial intelligence to an extreme. I'll go back, say, 20 years ago, when that it was ready, when you could talk to one another and see each other's face and see where everybody was, and the people said, no, I don't want anybody to see the way I'm dressed, the way I look, and everything else. So it's taken 20, 25 years to launch it today on what you got as FaceTime, because they didn't want that privacy to go. So ultimately, at the end of the day, there'll be a balance which will arrive. It will never go to one extreme, because ultimately, it's the humans that matter more than even robotics. So robotics and artificial intelligence will be used. There's no question in my mind, but it has to be used, what I would call maybe intelligently, so that you don't disrupt everybody. You don't disrupt the people. Is the world ready for whatever you are doing? And ultimately, that will decide, because even in America or anywhere where it is done, I mean, ultimately, like, they are miles ahead. They know exactly what you're doing. So somebody asked me, I was appearing on television, and they were against Aadhaar. And I said, why are you against Aadhaar card? Because I'm giving up my personal privacy, they know what I do, my name, why should I tell anybody? I said, fine. So there were about 3 young people like y'all. This is about maybe 3-4 years ago when Aadhaar had come in. I said, you carrying a phone? They said, yes. You know what Google knows about you? They know much more than what Aadhaar will ever know. They know exactly where you're going, which Aadhaar doesn't know, that where you are, what you... Then they started looking. Then one guy came up and said, no, but it is my personal choice that I've gone onto the phone. I said, now let's discuss what is privacy. So ultimately, at the end of the day, if you are ready, how many of you read all the terms and conditions which you press on your phone and say, I'm ready? Nobody reads it. So ultimately, at the end of the day, you're giving up so much to Google, so much to Facebook without your knowledge. And that is the most dangerous thing that is happening. And therefore, before you say about privacy, please look at what you've already given up. And then talk to the government on saying, I don't want to give up. Ultimately, I ask them, there's 1.3 billion people here, 1.3 or 1.4 billion in China. Are they really interested, you know, on you? Maybe they are interested in about 100 people, where they are going, what they are doing. And they really have to be worried about their privacy. Why are you worried? 1.4 billion records they'll have to go through for you. I mean, each one is now talking like mad about privacy. So ultimately, I just say that, look, be careful about artificial intelligence. Use it intelligently. And as far as plumbing is concerned, no artificial intelligence can come and fix a leak in your house. No matter how much you know, you will still have to call that plumber. And when the electricity will go off and you're sitting over there and you're scared, if I put my finger here, I'll be burned to death. Have to call an expert in. No amount of artificial intelligence will help you there. So you order a pizza, how is artificial intelligence going to be delivered to your house? Artificial intelligence will tell you where it's available. So you know, they will tell you the rate, they will tell you everything. Now it's up to you to use it and call for it. So it will be a balance which will be struck, according to me, rather than extreme forms of one or the other.
Great. So he says, don't be too worried about it. And there is a basis for what he's saying. I think it happened, say, when Industrial Revolution happened a few hundred years before. People thought, ab to sab jobs chale jayenge. Ford ka humko yaad hi hai, Ford ke jo workers union leader tha. To Ford ne kaha ki ab to jo aap log kaam kar rahe hai, wo sab automatically ho sakta hai, mujhe aap log koi zarurat nahi hai. And the union leader said, zarurat to phir bhi aapko rahegi, kyunki iske baad kharidega kaun? यदि मशीन ही बनाएंगे तो फाइनली खरीदने के लिए तो आपके पास लोग होने चाहिए, वरना कौन खरीदेगा. सो आई फील दैट देयर इज अ मैरिट. व्हेन इंडस्ट्रियल रेवोल्यूशन हैपेंड वी थॉट कि सब जॉब चले जाएंगे. जब कंप्यूटर्स हुए, अभी रिसेंटली आई थिंक जब हम लोगों ने काम शुरू किया था, that most of us felt the computer aa gaye to let's oppose it. One computer would take 10 people's jobs, and we know that world has emerged better from that. Today, I think I can say that we are almost at a golden era of human species. We have GDP which is high. We have a life situation which is much better, that most of us have some other machine or intelligence to do what we don't want to do. Global GDP divided by total population is something like $10,000, which means that globally each one of us has a GDP of about 7 lakh rupees. So we are saying, and it is growing at 2%, then I think our sons would be double rich than us. If it is growing at 1% global GDP, then our grandchildren would be double rich than what we are. So we are at a golden period of time. Our world pie is big, in the sense that GDP is total big. It is growing at a good rate. Quality of GDP is also better. Like if you say 500 years before, most of us were working in farms. Difficult situation, difficult working condition. Then came factories. So we all shifted to working in factories, working with machines, we were feeling better. Then we all came to offices. Service sector grew up, which means that from factories, the jobs came to offices, which is much better for us. Now, 40 years from now, I think in office also, we would have artificial intelligence and robotics to deal with. So far as we are dealing with them appropriately, dealing with them intelligently, I think it's going to create a good quality of life. I feel a real situation is that most of us would have more free time. Most of the work that we don't want to do or we are doing slow would be done faster by intelligent machines. And therefore, I remember having read Bertrand Russell in his book which he wrote about 100 years before on praise of idleness. There he had said that if the world total work is to be divided among total world's population, each one of us would have about 2-3 hours of work. So 2-3 hours of work to take care of our requirements, to see that the world would keep progressing, and remaining time we would have free to do whatever we are good at. So ye shayad music bajayenge, main shayad poem likhunga, koi aur drama karenge. So you would do whatever it is that inspires you, whatever it is that is meaning of life for you. There would be enough time to do that. I think that situation would come. Perhaps we would all have 2-3 hours of work where we would have machines which would do faster, more intelligent work. Remaining time perhaps would be taken up for entertainment, for what would absorb us, for what is our expression of life. And there we would need to kind of, you know, come up with maybe content which is more interactive, which is more absorbing, which is more relevant. And our ability to deal with extra time, which would be free time, which we don't need to spend on earning money, is something that I think we all need to think through as to what would we do if we have time. And say universal basic income is one concept which is coming, that if the jobs are taken away, and Switzerland parliament is debating it, I think saying that universal basic income is required, which means that if all the jobs are going to go away by machines or 90%, you give assurance to people about a universal business income which would come to you, universal basic income which would keep coming to you. And if you do that, you would have money that is required for you to exist well. You would have a lot of free time, and you would have yourself to deal with all this situation. I think this situation ko bhi main dekh raha hu. Aap kaise dekh rahe ho?
See, dekhiye, aap jo keh rahe na, Europe mein when they are doing all this, there the population is aging, and everyone is not producing children anymore. So the problem in Europe and America and even UK is very different from India and China. When I say that they have got to take care, so you have spare time, they are looking after you, whatever. And I think I went to St. Gallen University about 3 years ago, and I told, they were in one of the subsections like this, and I raised a question with them saying, what is the biggest threat to democracy in the United States of America? And I said, it's you aging people. Because all the money that is being cut in your taxes is for your social security. And there were only two youngsters there, about 25 years old, the rest were 40 plus. All the 40 plus started jumping on me. I said, what will happen to democracy is that nobody is going to interfere with what you have worked for. You've got the 2 hours of time, you can play the flute, do whatever you like, but you can't vote anymore. Because ultimately, I am the one who gets taxed for you to carry on. So the younger generation are going to say, your social security is safe. You can carry on doing whatever you want. But please don't vote, because you will vote for us to be taxed more, and we are the ones who are working. So therefore, you have to understand that what is the threat to democracy in those advanced countries. In our country, the question is the change of attitude, is the question of saying that, look, how do I use, because every educational in school and college tells you, go and get a job. Your parents are very disappointed if you say, sahab, main to electrician banna chahta hu, main to carpenter banna. Arey, aapko itna padhaya likhaya, aapko desk job dena chahiye, IAS mein jaiye, aap engineer kyun nahi ban rahe hain, wahan pe jaiye. So the question is, do we need to change and become relevant? Once you become relevant, maybe if you've got something in artificial intelligence, create for five other carpenters, start a small company na. Aap panch carpenter, panch electrician who work for you. Anybody makes a call, your electrician goes. How do you remain relevant becomes more important. See, as you said earlier, jab television aaya, to everybody said cinema, nobody is going to go to the halls. How did cinema halls become relevant again? They said, you're missing your popcorn, you're not going, we are making the seats more comfortable, enjoy the movie in 3D and 5D, which you can't do on your TV. So the question is that they are making themselves relevant all over again, because they are looking at what are the people looking for. And that's what the whole circle of life is going to be. Everything that's going out of fashion has to be brought back into fashion, become more relevant. That's the way I look at it, because otherwise you're going in one area for China and India, there will be no jobs for anyone. Cool job here. Our education sir, better way, I want a desk job. Impossible. It's not going to happen. And therefore it's very important. See, what technology should be used for, I've written down. One, it makes you more efficient. There's no question. Can automate manual processes, to our offices mein jaldi se aa jayega. Flexibility now comes in. You can be working from anywhere. Aap office bhi mat jaiye, aapke paas computer hai, aap kaam karte rahiye wahan pe, yeah, on the phone. So that is what most companies will have to start realizing. Working hours can become flexible. Koi 11 baje aa raha hai, koi 12 baje aa raha hai, but they are available at 9 o'clock also at home. They've got, the mother has to look after the child, she's got a computer. If you want to get in touch with her, get in touch with her. She doesn't have to be physically in the office. So how do you use technology to bring about some level of comfort? And there's increased collaboration. But let me tell you, face to face, everything that requires face to face, that is the danger of going the other extreme. And I cannot believe that humans are not going to work towards some kind of thing of how to remain face to face. There are many things that are required face to face. How do you get married? How do you date? Are you going to date on a computer? You want to go face to face. There are many areas where you will have to work out, and that's the danger of swinging to the other extreme, which I hold, is that look, human race itself will say enough is enough. Joe, what is useful, I'm going to use. What is not useful, I'm going to discard. Because I have to look after everything. Cybersecurity now, how much, you know, if you're going to rely on only artificial intelligence, you're complaining about security. Everybody can hack your phone now. You have 10 hackers, they'll come, kiska aapko information chahiye, pay them, and therefore you're getting another industry coming up of hackers. Kiska hack karwana karwa lijiye, mujhe paisa de dijiye. So are you creating another world of hackers? Are you creating another world of, to protect your cyber security? IP theft is going to be massive. So you've got to be careful of all the pluses and minuses of artificial intelligence. I'm not against it. But I'm against the fact that if everything can be done by machines, then what the hell are we here for? There are many things that can't be done.
बिल्कुल तो शादी तो कर भी लोगे पर बच्चे हो वो तो कैसे करेंगे मिलना तो पड़ेगा. So I understand what you say. I think this is a good time to now perhaps stop and have some question answer, unless you would want to make some last comments. I thought then let's have some question answer based on what we said on entrepreneurship, on future of work, on artificial intelligence, on robotics, what you see the future jobs like. So I think over to you on question answer.
Hum to apna bachchon ko kehte rehte hain, become old. That 1962, I think Mohammad Rafi sang after that Chinese war, hum to desh kar chuke hawale tumhare. I mean, you all have to decide what you all want. We are to be used only to facilitate what you want now, the older generation. That's it. We are just facilitators. You have to decide what you want, what you don't want, what you want from your country, what you want from the world. And that is why whenever you ask for Q&A, that's an easy part for us to try and tell you what we think. That's about it. But your thought process, you decide for yourself.
So it's also at the end, what do you want out of the session? So please ask questions so that that's what you get from this session, other than what we already said.
There is one saying about the teacher. There is one saying about the teacher. No technology can replace a teacher. And if any technology replaces a teacher, then better to replace that teacher.
That's a statement.
पर जरूर आई थिंक और टीचर तो फिर भी कहीं आपको ऑनलाइन टीचिंग में मिल जाए पर इफ यू आर टॉकिंग ऑफ गुरु इन अ वे जो हमारे सिचुएशन में देयर इज अ फर्क बिटवीन गुरु एंड अ टीचर टीचर यू नो एनीबॉडी कैन टीच यू एनीथिंग एनीवेयर पर यदि हां और ये जो गुरु है आपको वो थोड़ी यही सिखाता है व्हेन आई वेंट टू आईएम अहमदाबाद आई वाज द ओनली लोकल फ्रॉम अहमदाबाद हु गॉट इनटू आईएम अहमदाबाद एडमिशन तो मैंने कहा भाई मुझे रहने की क्या जरूरत है मैं तो घर पे रहूंगा अपने सवेरे आऊंगा क्लास करके शाम को चला जाऊंगा दिस इट ये तो है ही नहीं बिकॉज आप समझिए कि क्लास में टीचिंग हो रही है तो अलग बात है मोर लर्निंग हैपेंस व्हेन यू आर इन द कॉरिडोर व्हेन यू आर टॉकिंग टू योर फ्रेंड्स व्हेन यू आर सिपिंग अ कप ऑफ टी विद योर गुरु दैट इज व्हेन द रियल नॉलेज एक्सचेंज हैपेंस एंड सो इट्स अ कंपल्सरी रेजिडेंशियल प्रोग्राम कि आपको वहीं रह के यू हैव टू ब्रीथ दैट एयर लर्न फ्रॉम दैट
आई मस्ट टेल यू अबाउट द गुजराती व्हेन आई वाज स्टडीइंग इन आईएम कलकत्ता And this is just a joke, huh? Don't take it very seriously about it. But just to bring in a little bit of humor, four of us used to sit down together in the evening and whatever project we had to do, we used to sit together, we used to discuss something and then we went back to our rooms and we wrote. So three of us, when we got our papers back, we all got B plus for some reason. We wrote it in our own way. He got an A. So we caught hold of this Gujarati friend of ours and said, why were you not telling us everything? You let all your friends down, you're out of our group. He said, nahi yaar, you wait till all the papers are written, read my paper and tell me that I've written anything that we didn't discuss. Then when we read his paper, he wrote over there, one school of thought has this, one school, another school of thought, and he got an A. Because the teacher said, schools of thought, he's read a lot of books. One school of thought was mine, another school of thought was someone else's. So a Gujarati brain always gets an A because he put all our thoughts as a school of thought. Now that is most important and that's why he got an A. So we said, we are idiots. In not having thought of it as he thought.
But that was just an aside. Whatever you all want to ask. I love this silence because I can go to Delhi to catch my flight. Go ahead. I wanted to ask something for you.
What is the main being an entrepreneur, what is the major advice which you would like to give to an entrepreneur?
I would add a few things and I think he has worked a lot on entrepreneurship so he would have a last word on that question. But I am saying that